During our time last week in the first part of Philippians 2, we learned that one aspect of the joy God wants us to live in is having humility that imitates our Savior, Lord Jesus. By faith, we are united with Christ, and humility before Him is integral to our growth in faith. By faith, we also are expected then to be humble before other people, especially other Christians. This humility doesn't mean that we turn into doormats. It does mean that we place others' needs and desires above our own. What's best for them comes first in our thinking and actions. Of course, this imitates the love of the Lord Jesus, who set aside His heavenly glory to step into our sinful, violent, messy world in order to save us from our sin. And for that humility, the Father exalted Jesus. When we humble ourselves, He will also lift us up in honor, as we read from James 4. To continue in Philippians today, we're going to read from chapter 2, starting at verse 12. Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill His good purpose. Do everything without grumbling or arguing, so that you may become blameless and pure, children of God, without fault in a warped and crooked generation. Then you will shine among them like stars in the sky as you hold firmly to the word of life. And then I will be able to boast on the day of Christ that I did not run or labor in vain. But even if I am being poured out like a drink offering on the sacrifice and service coming from your faith, I am glad and rejoice with all of you. So you too should be glad and rejoice with me. This is God's holy word from the Scriptures. Most of us face the challenge of balance first in our lives when we learn how to ride a bike. When the training wheels are on, we slowly get used to the feeling of riding. When the training wheels come off, we may falter or even crash, but our attempts ultimately enable us the freedom that balance gives us to explore our world and feel the wind in our faces. That's much like how it works when we learn the balance of spirituality in other areas of life. We try to balance work and leisure, career and family, food and exercise, and faith and day-to-day life. Now, you and I also have to balance activity and social time with some seclusion as we guard against possible virus exposure. Only when we have a healthy level of balance in these various aspects can we have God-honoring lives of purpose. In today's scripture, Paul gives us helpful instruction about such balance and how that balance can strengthen our witness of the love and power of God at work in us. We're going to start by looking at verses 12 and 13, where Paul teaches how to balance purpose and freedom. Let's reread it. Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill His good purpose. The second phrase of verse 12, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, is much misunderstood. Paul is not teaching that a Christian must do something to earn salvation. He also doesn't intend that once we've been blessed with salvation, we have to keep working in order to keep that redemption. And if we don't, we'll lose it. We know this, first of all, because Paul wrote this foundational truth in Ephesians 2. It is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Our salvation and our life after we come to faith is all by grace, a precious gift that keeps on giving until He takes us home to glory. Since it's all by God's grace, of course it is right to give Him all the honor and glory for whatever good we do and whatever we accomplish. So we know that Paul doesn't mean about working out our salvation with fear and trembling, that we have to earn salvation and then earn to keep it. But what does he mean? First of all, we need to keep in mind that he is writing to believers, so in context, he's talking about how to live out that free gift of faith. The Greek word that's translated work out means work to full completion, and was used to describe a farmer working a field. Our lives have tremendous potential for bearing worthwhile fruit, just like a field. We don't finish the work God gives us in a day or two. We have to keep at it. Once we work through one part of our field, we'll need to keep at it and tend it and make sure the crops in that part of our field have the best chance to grow. We may make mistakes caring for our field, or even sin in doing so. We also may and probably will suffer loss or even devastation. But it's still the field God has blessed us with, and our Lord wants to help us fulfill the immense potential He's given us in that field. He wants us to have joy in our life's field. And when we have joy, He delights in us all the more. Something that can be hard for you and me is that we don't always like the word work. In our culture, it's something to be avoided or minimized or not taken all that seriously. Many people mistakenly think that there will be no work in heaven, which probably isn't true. God intends work to be a very good thing for us and a benefit for others. Work is intended to help us reach our full potential as people, of course, aside from putting food on the table and a roof over our heads. In the Old Testament, there was a lot of work associated with religion because God's people had a lot to do to take part in worship and abide by the law. Sacrificial offerings had to be made. Pilgrimages had to be taken to Jerusalem, and tithes had to be given. Work, work, work. Now that you and I are in the New Testament age of grace, we need to take a fresh look at the value and meaning of work, especially when it comes to growing in our relationship with the Lord. One of the books I use for my daily devotions is called Diamonds in the Dust by Johnny Erickson Tada. January 21st, there was a wonderful devotion that talks about this very topic. As her springboard, Johnny uses Galatians 3:22-25, which reads, "The scriptures declare that we are all prisoners of sin. So we receive God's promise of freedom only by believing in Jesus Christ. Before the way of faith in Christ was available to us, we were placed under guard by the law. We were kept in protective custody, so to speak, until the way of faith was revealed. course, that's talking about the Old Testament era. We were kept in protective custody, as I said, so to speak, until the way of faith was revealed. That was verse 23. Then Paul says, let me put it another way. The law was our guardian until Christ came. It protected us until we could be made right with God through faith. And now that the way of faith has come, we no longer need the law as our guardian. To sum up, these are my words, we are free in Christ to live not under the burden of a law, but in the freedom the Holy Spirit gives us to obey. Not because of duty, but from a sense of joy and love for God. So Johnny goes on then to make her own comments about this passage from Galatians 3. She says, sometimes the sins we commit are not moral ones, but spiritual. We cultivate a legal attitude toward God, and that's wrong. Christians start out in the Spirit, but then when it comes to daily living, we try to perfect ourselves by the flesh. The law says, do these things and you shall live. But the gospel says, live and you will do these things. The law demands holiness, but the gospel gives holiness. The law makes blessings the result of obedience, but the gospel makes obedience the result of blessings from God. If we are right in our inward being, we shall certainly do right in our outward actions. And that is what Christian liberty is all about. This is an excellent way to think about the mindset change that had to happen when people came to faith, especially in the first century. Johnny goes on to add that through faith in Christ, our motive to obey and serve the Lord is not from obligation or duty or a sense of guilt, but for love. Love for God. That is what must grow in us as we work out our salvation with fear and trembling. This work is not about labor. It's about love for God. And that love can't grow from our own effort. That's the key point here. It only grows through the help the Holy Spirit gives us. We rely upon Him for growth, just as a farmer relies on the Lord for rain and sun to grow crops. We see this more clearly back in Philippians 2, verse 13, where we learn that it is God who works in us to will and to act in order to fulfill His good purpose. So even here we see this working out with fear and trembling is because God works in us. The Greek word that's used here for God working is equivalent to our English term energizing. So we may be energized through inspiration gained by reading God's word, or singing, or powerful encouragement from a friend, or any other wonderful thing like that. But other times we can be energized. Well, it's more like being electrically shocked. God moves us, but the process might be painful. God works in so many ways to get our attention, to accomplish His good plan in us, and sometimes those ways are uncomfortable or downright frightening. You likely know that fact already. Even so, we still might have a hang-up with this verse. Paul says that we should work out our salvation with fear and trembling. And that doesn't sound joyful or energizing at all. There are cats in the background, excuse me. fear and trembling actually sounds horrible. Some of that is due to the limits of our Greek to English translation. But I'll turn to Gordon Fee, a renowned scholar, to explain the gist of this phrase. He says, one does not live out the gospel casually or lightly, but as one who knows what it means to stand in awe of the living God. Nothing of failure or lack of confidence is implied. The gospel is God's thing, and the God who has saved his people is an awesome God. And that's where the fear and trembling comes in. So you and I regard our salvation with holy awe and wonder, and guard against taking it and the Lord for granted. Moises Silva adds that while our work to grow in holiness requires conscious effort and concentration, our activity takes place not in a legalistic spirit with a view to gaining God's favor, but rather in a spirit of humility and thanksgiving, recognizing that without Christ, we can do nothing. That's from John 15. And so Christ alone deserves the glory. Moises Silva is another very wonderful scholar. In fact, the more that we work, the more that we are aware that we don't do so under our own strength, but the Lord's. And this adds all the more to our joy and our awe, our humility, and our thanksgiving. I love it. You know, I quoted before from John Erickson Tata from last week's devotion, and I love when God does this. Last night, January 27th, he gave me another devotion that goes along with this wonderfully, so I'm going to share it. This is from Our Daily Bread, and it's written by Patricia Raybon. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but it talks about what we mean by freedom, because I think spiritual freedom is something that we don't really talk about a lot. We think about it intellectually, maybe, but not as it plays out and how it plays out in daily life. So she talks about freedom. And the freedom comes because Jesus gave up his life to secure that freedom. Then she says, now as his children, we know it is for freedom that Christ has set us free, as Paul boldly declared in Galatians 5. The Gospel of John also teaches of freedom in Christ, noting, if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. From John 8. And this is the part that I think is important for us. But free in what ways? In Jesus, we experience freedom, not only from sin and its hold on us, but also from guilt, shame, worry, Satan's lies, superstitions, false teaching, and eternal death. No longer hostages, we have freedom to show love to enemies, walk in kindness, live with hope, and love our neighbors. As we follow the Holy Spirit's leading, we can forgive as we've been forgiven. For all of this, let's thank God today. And then let's love so others will know the power of his freedom, too. I love that quote. So far, we have seen that God desires us to balance purpose in life with spiritual freedom. The key to keeping that balance is to remember that both our purpose in life and our spiritual freedom are both gifts from him, and they are to be cherished and cultivated. Our second balancing task has to do with our attitude. It's found in verses 14 to 16, which again say, Do everything without grumbling or arguing, so that you may become blameless and pure, children of God without fault in a warped and crooked generation. Then you will shine among them like stars in the sky, as you hold firmly to the word of life. And then I will be able to boast on the day of Christ that I did not run or labor in vain. Do you know someone who complains a lot? I hope it's not you, but do you know someone who does? Someone who would complain if they didn't have something to complain about? A person who argues and gripes and nitpicks on a regular basis. Not only are they annoying, they suck the joy out of a room. This is certainly a harmful way to live for anyone, but it should never be the case for a Christian who is growing to love the Lord and live in joy. In the Greek, there is special emphasis here on the words, do everything without grumbling. Do everything. The point being that nothing should have a trace of complaining or arguing if you are a Jesus follower. And this arguing isn't rational arguing in the sense of making a case. This is arguing just being nasty and nitpicking. Now, we may think complaints, but we hold those thoughts captive and we don't speak them to infect other people. I may gripe inside that it's another rainy day, but if I say that a lot, it's going to annoy people and bring them down. And then when we've thought those things and we've held them captive, we ask the Lord to take them away from us. We ask him to heal us of whatever attitude has slanted us away from his love and joy. There are plenty of things to complain about in the world. We all do it a little bit, but we don't want to make a lifestyle out of it. And we can pick an argument about on any given matter if we really want to. But as believers, we are not to do that ever. Ever? Never. Because if we are seeking to live in joy, celebrating God's presence in our lives, telling others about him, we won't have the time or energy or inclination to complain or argue. We're too busy praising the Lord. So I might gripe that it's raining again, but the proper way to think about it is, thank you, Lord, that I'm living another day and that you're providing rain. We want to see God's hand in our lives. He's at work in our midst, and we'll be busy praising him. We'll be too busy giving thanks and being grateful. By God's grace and power, we are balancing how we feel and want to act with how we better need to feel and better need to act. The Holy Spirit gives us the freedom to choose to step away from griping to feel joy. We choose to give thanks instead of nitpick and gripe. And by making these simple choices, which actually then become a good habit, we show love to others as well as the Lord, because instead of sucking the joy out of a room, we are filling it with God's love shining through us. Celebrated preacher Charles Spurgeon once said, "We have no more right to put our discordant state of mind into the lives of those around us and rob them of their sunshine and brightness, than we have to enter their houses and steal their silverware." We live in a world that's full of griping and complaining. To be different really is to shine light into people's lives, and I think they will take notice. The Apostle Paul urges the alternative, especially in verses 15 to 16. He teaches the Philippians to show the difference Jesus has made in their hearts through a lifestyle of kindness and integrity that inspires non-believers. Reading it again, "Do everything without grumbling or arguing, so that you may become blameless and pure, children of God without fault in a warped and crooked generation. Then you will shine among them like stars in the sky, as you hold firmly to the word of life. And then I will be able to boast on the day of Christ that I did not run or labor in vain." So Paul says that the Philippians can prove that they are different by striving to grow in specific ways. First, by being blameless, meaning that they are to live above justifiable criticism. This is explored further in 1 Peter 3, where that apostle writes, "In your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience, so that those who speak maliciously against your good behavior in Christ may be ashamed of their slander." In other words, our accusers shouldn't have a good leg to stand on. Second, Paul says the Philippians are to be harmless or pure, meaning that there's nothing in their hearts that hints of malice. Their identity as God's children, as brothers and sisters of Christ Jesus, will be obvious. Such a believer is working to get rid of anything that would defile or dilute God's image in them. Again, they're not perfect, but they are striving sincerely to be holy. Stuart Briscoe paraphrases this verse by saying, "He is a real child of God who believes like one and behaves like one, and has nothing in his life that people can get after him about." The child of God Paul describes here shines among unbelievers like stars in the sky. This may sound simplistic for me to ask, but what do stars do? Of course, they shine brightly, of course, but they also shine steadily. They flicker a bit from our perspective, but they can be counted on to be found shining. Humans throughout history have used the stars as guides to get them home. And we shine brightly to guide the people around us to Jesus. And we need to be counted on to be there for them as we do this. And nothing can extinguish the stars. Not Satan, not COVID, not illness, not grumpiness. Nothing can extinguish the light in us because it isn't our light. It's the Lord's, and He never fails. All we have to do in our spiritual freedom is let His goodness and love shine through us the best we can, day by day. Now, no doubt Paul picked this image up from Jesus' words in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5. Our Savior tells us that we are the light of the world because He is the light of the world. He grants us the power and the spiritual brilliance to be so. We've all heard the song, "This Little Light of Mine," but the truth is that we don't have a little light. In Christ's power and presence, we are blazing giant stars. So this stupendous and gigantic light of mine, I'm going to let it radiate vividly. It's definitely not easy to sing, but it's much more accurate. This stupendous and gigantic light of mine, I'm going to let it radiate vividly. Even with that vivid radiation of life and joy, we still need to balance some serious issues. We all know that life's bowl of cherries has plenty of pits. Paul shows this in verses 17 to 18. He's planning to be proud of the Philippians on the day Jesus returns. And then he says, "But even if I am being poured out like a drink offering on the sacrifice and service coming from your faith, I am glad and rejoice with all of you. So you too should be glad and rejoice with me." Paul knew that his entire life in Christ was an offering to the Lord. Facing possible martyrdom brought this reality into sharp focus. But he refused to dwell on the dark side of the situation. He's already said that to live is Christ, and to die is gain. With every circumstance, there is joy when the reality of God's presence is that which we're most attuned to. Paul rejoices in the Philippians' growth in faith, and they should rejoice that he's been able to turn his situation, being imprisoned, toward being kingdom-furthering, God-honoring, and soul-saving. Paul mentioned thoughts like these before, and he's going to do it again as we proceed through this letter. No matter what we're going through, God is with us, so we can have true peace and joy and hope. But we have to choose that attitude. No matter how we sin or fail, as his children, we are forgiven, and he calls us to continue to work out our salvation with his gracious help. So today we've thought about balancing our purpose in life with spiritual freedom, our attitude and lifestyle, and we've also thought about serious issues balanced with hope and joy in the Lord. There's a lot here to think through and chew on, and I encourage you to reflect on these verses again, especially as they relate to your relationship with Jesus. I'm going to close with an apt quote from Warren Wiersbe. He says, "Life is not a series of disappointing ups and downs." Again, here's another choice of attitude. "Rather, it is a sequence of delightful ins and outs. God works in, and we work out. The example comes from Christ, the energy comes from the Holy Spirit, and the result is joy." My prayer is that this may be true of each and every one of us more and more, day by day. Amen.